So next week, we will report to you on that. We hope time to have done it. Now we move on to the law breaking of John C. Malone, Robert Magnus, Communications Incorporated, TCI. And to Barry Marshall and Brian Sullivan and Brendan Clouston. And Peter N. Gallivan and Nafee and O'Brien. And I told you Brian Sullivan up in Albany. Mary Magarelli and John Wicker and Scott Brown and Nona Carey Dunn and Miles Rich in Westchester for breaking the state law. No cable operator shall prohibit or limit or exercise editorial control over public use of channel, and the breaking of the analogous federal law that no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel. By taking away public access, Channel 8, system-wide, these TCI greedy cable operators have made public access so burdensome that people can't do it, and that thereby is an improper infringement of freedom of speech, and it's against everything that Congress legislated in the Cable Act of 1984 as amended in 1992. I thought the rally was very good. I love the tuba and the banjo. I'm afraid that the people are afraid of TCI. When you go to a rally, you have to do what you're there for. Down with TCI, down with Scott Brown, down with Miles Rich, down with John Wicker, down with John Malone, down with Bob Magnus. These are the people who made this decision. It's against the law, and it's a violation of rights. And so you can't be afraid of them. You have to go there and state your case. News that has come in is that Nat Taff came over, and he has three supervisors who he thinks will go to the hearing before Judge Connor on January 23rd in courtroom 610 at Coropas in Lexington, here in White Plains. Judge Connor did not sign my temporary restraining order and my preliminary injunction, but he called a conference for it. And that conference, of course, is going to be TCI, you show cause why you should not be restrained and enjoined. And Glendora and the others who come will show cause why they should be enjoined for doing the outrageous thing that they're planning to do as of February. The New York Times called her editor, the reporter's editor, told, assigned her to this story to keep watch over it. And so Glendora sent her the copy of the lawsuit and the summons and the civil cover sheet and the order to show cause and the affidavit in support of and the memorandum of law in support of. And it took all of Tuesday, the 16th, from 9:30 a.m. to 5:30 in the afternoon. It came out to something like, and then what else had to be done, 12 and a half hours. And the case was filed, and the order to show cause was signed, and it was certified. And to the marshals went a certified copy of the summons and a certified copy of the IFP and the copy of the complaint and a certified copy of the order to show cause and the affidavit and the memorandum. That was all taken down to 500 Pearl Street in Manhattan, and it was submitted to the United States Marshals. and it was faxed to the United States Marshals in Denver and in Albany and here in White Plains. So the marshals will go out and serve these lawbreakers, and that is good. The suit is on. The defendants are in a position that I would not like to be in. And let's see what else happened. The costs have been added up for the week, but the costs, I haven't had time to do the TCI lawbreaking log for the week of the 15th. But I think I do have the cost for the week of the 8th. Somewhere. Now, is there anything else? The editing is all up to date and the videotaping is all up to date as to what TCI is doing. William Ragone is working very hard on this. Municipalities that TCI is trying to dump us on are not able to do this. They're not able to take our programs. There's about 50 or 60 public access producers. I did prevail on getting a list of the public access producers and their names and addresses. There is a cop-out on telephone numbers, and I think that that's required. So, go to court on Tuesday, January the 23rd at 9 a.m. to Judge Connor, and that's in courtroom 610. And I think that's all the news on TCI for the week from Friday, the January 12th, to today, Thursday, January the 17th. Bob says that he diets religiously, and come to find out that means he doesn't eat during church. And have you heard about the Army diet? Everything you eat goes to the front. And Harry eats nothing but bananas and drinks nothing but coconut. He hasn't milk. He hasn't lost any weight, folks, but boy, can he climb trees. And that's a chat with Glendora. We've got an interesting clipping here at Nancy Crosby. Wanted a place to live, and everything was so expensive, and she went to Yonkers, and she met this woman, Nellie Wilder, who was 80 years old, and she wanted somebody to live in, Nellie wanted somebody to live in the house with her, and so they talked, and they liked each other, and Nancy moved in with her, and Nancy says, what will I pay you? And Nellie says, no, you don't have to pay any money. So that's pretty nice, isn't it? Sharing a home provides help and companionship. That's nice, because Nellie doesn't want to leave her home. So that's good. A bad announcement is the crookedness of Payne Weber and A.G. Edwards and Dean Winter and Merrill Lynch when you go to buy stock. You really get ripped off. And it just, it's really sleazy, the way stock is sold by these people, and that's their business. And let's see if there's any other announcers. No, I think we're all up to date. What's way down here? Oh, the names of the people I sued for TCI. And I think I covered them all with you. Yeah. So that's it. So we must have a Bible passage, and this is a Bible passage from Romans 14, verse 12. So then, every one of us shall give account of himself to God. All these people trying to take away your rights will have to give an account to God. And all of the courts and all of the bad judges and all of the rip-off court stenographers will have to give an account of themselves before God. And this is a chat with Glendora, and it's closing on January the 18th, 1996, Thursday. I believe, thanks to Fred Strauss and White Plains, that the editing is up to date. There's only like 4.5 programs to edit today and one program to make a dub of. And so we could possibly bring the editing up to date, which would be the first time the editing has been brought up to date since Judge Fox took a Wednesday afternoon. And, well, he didn't take it. It's the lying and lawbreaking of the Cablevision defendants, ignorant and arrogant, who messed it up. And since that day was taken to be in Judge Fox's court, and I believe it was on December 27th, we've been behind. It might have been before that. But now we might have a chance to catch it up. You take care, folks, and guard your rights. Somebody will try to take your rights every way possible. You just stand up for them. Keep your courage flaming. She has a lawsuit against Cablevision. She's a lawyer. Now, to erase these messages, you press this.
Enter, yes, to confirm.
And make sure you to erase them because you want to erase them, and you have to press yes.
Messages erased.
Welcome, everybody, to A Chat with Glendora. This is the Westchester edition, and this is what happened from last Thursday. whatever that was, to today, which is the 25th, so last Thursday would have been the 18th. And here are some jokes. You know those talking scales? You get on the scale and a voice announces how much you weigh. Well, Evelyn got on the scale and the voice said, please, one at a time. And Marilyn says she's a light eater. And her mother-in-law says, that's right, as soon as it gets light, she starts to eat. I've been doing very well, folks. Let's see, yesterday I didn't eat. My goal was not to eat until 3 p.m. But because of the law breaking and the lies and the cover-ups and setting the record straight, it takes so long to do that. And also because of weak judges, I didn't get to eat until about 4:30. That was yesterday, Wednesday. And Tuesday, my intention was to fast until 2 p.m. And but again, because of the emergencies and urgencies that don't have to happen in this life, but are caused by lying lawyers and law-breaking defendants and judges who don't do their work, I didn't get to eat until about 3:30. And Monday, my goal was to fast until 1 p.m., and I made that easily. So today, it's up to 3 p.m., and I hope to keep that down. And it has helped a little. I'm down to 172 pounds. Franklin is 158 pounds, and that's worries, because he's 6'1". He's too skinny. Peter said to Paul, did the doctor get you back onto your feet? And Paul said, he certainly did. When I got the bill, I had to sell the car. I'm reporting to you on the law breaking of James Daniel, Roberta Walsh, Nella, and Theo Alpucci, and Andrew and Kevin Larkin, and on the lying and covering up by their lawyers, Wilson Babe, Convoy Koza, Cousins, Odell McGrath, Karamitsos, and Bendish, and by the very bad and unjust and incompetent work of Judge Harold Wood and Judge Angelo Ingrassia, and of Wood's law clerk, Carlucci. And on January the 19th, 1996, Friday, it was a day of peace, 51 degrees, and it rained, and it cleared all of the snow out of our parking space. At 7:35 p.m., we were driving up Rutherford Hill, and Roberta was walking down the hill, and there was no incident. That is good. But Sunday, the cellar was in pretty good shape. This is a report on landlord-tenant relations and also neighbor-to-neighbor relations to help you folks who are having problems in those areas. The laundry machine worked beautifully. And there was a new face in the laundry room. We don't know whether it was an intruder. It might be the new people in apartment 1C. 6:15 to 6:30 p.m., James Walsh and his guest, Billy. Billy's very good looking. He's blonde and blue-eyed. But they were turning the cellar, the laundry area, into a playground. And they had a hard ball that they were throwing up against the walls. There was a lot of voice noise. Glendora checked it out. And then Franklin went down and witnessed it. And Glendora went back, and going upstairs, Glendora clearly said twice, grounds for eviction, grounds for eviction. And the following morning, Glendora informed the owner, John Porzio, via telephone. No, first of all, informed John Porzio's answering service. And that's on audio tape 764, side one. And James told Billy, you stay here. And then James went upstairs to get his father and his mother, but neither, who are less mature than James is, but neither one of them responded. James came back and continued the law breaking with Billy. It lasted until 6:50 p.m. and there were signs until 8 p.m. and then there was another outburst of a half an hour, and that's two people, and that's harassed, intentional, infliction of emotional disturbance and the White Plains Noise Ordinance. And that would be, and it's times 2 hours, and so that'd be 12 tortious acts. James was feeding Glendora's cat, Felicia, in the cellar outside the hole that goes under Building B. There's no foundation under Building B. There's no foundation to a lot of this. And so Felicia went in there. She gets freaked out because somebody was very mean to her down cellar after I've worked so hard to get her over her fears. And she is our cat now. We have adopted her. She's sleeping right over there in the chair now. The number of tortious acts is 3,114. The number of pages of bad record are 3,864. This is mailing number 24 and exhibit number 89, and it's volume 34. And again, this is a wrong done by neighbor to neighbor, and this is a wrong done by landlord to tenant. As far as what has happened this week, it's good. In the morning, as I told you, I called John Porzio and I said that James Walsh and guest Billy turned the cellar into a playground, throwing a hard ball up against the wall and making a lot of voice noise, and Porzio says, call the police. I said, call the police? This happened on your property. It's not the police's responsibility, it's yours. And I say that that's grounds for eviction. And Porzio said, I hear you. The damages for this week were $4.00. Bendish has not submitted his respondents' brief either to me, the plaintiff appellant, or to the appellate division second department. So the question is, will he even answer? And number two, the question is, will he write honestly his own, or will he, like a schoolboy, copy Karamitsos? You know, in school that was not allowed, was it? To look over another student's shoulder copy. But when you're a lawyer, all the honesty and all of the integrity go for bucks. And so when you're a lawyer and a judge comes along and says, oh, man, that's okay with one lawyer to copy the paper of another. Yep, that's fine, these judges say. That's what's wrong with our society, is that we don't have judges who are any model of morality and ethics. We don't have that. They cheat and lie and do everything they can, all for personal gain. So that's it. Walsh, Alpucci, and Larkin on from January 18 to January today, 25. So, Delman, you knew that Glendora's appellant's reply brief was submitted on time, on the 16th of January, a very, very busy and impossible day of serving TCI on the order to show cause. And I don't know when the oral argument is. It's either the 5th or the 13th of February. I could call up, and I must do so, and find out which day the oral argument is. I do not want to be like Robert M. Callagy and not show up. On the appellate division, I called Guy James Mangano, the chief judge, and I asked Juanita there, or Rosalie, and I asked, did James Guy Mangano see it, and what did he think of it? I have not heard from Guy James Mangano. I called the chambers of William Thompson of the appellate division, second department, and I left a message with Carl. Did he see it and did he like it? And a couple of hours later, I got a call back. Yes, he saw it. Yes, he liked it. He liked, or he liked, it was the my videotape, a half an hour, which was shown in Nassau County Friday night, the 19th, the videotape of their 100th anniversary. Last prosecution of the White Plains Police, the videotape you saw last week. I went down and I pled not guilty, naturally, and I asked for a deposition by the policeman, and that is long overdue. Officer Stead should have had that in long ago. And I asked for a jury trial, but then I was told we don't have any jury trials in vehicle and traffic violations.
Okay, what else? I monitored the White Plains Court. Judge Kelman was there on Friday afternoon. And so I went in and I sat down to watch what was going on. I was tying my shoe when a New York State Court officer, we lost our White Plains policeman, the New York State Court officer, which I think is a move downward. And this court officer came over and I was tying my shoe and I heard him say, yes. And I looked up and I said, yes, what? And he said, can I help you? I said, no, thank you. And his attitude, certainly, and his bearing was that this is my court and you're not allowed to be in here except for my permission. And I think I clearly set him straight on that. It is not his court, it is the public's court. Courts are a public process. And always remember, you can walk into a court anytime. They are your courts. Sixth Amendment of the Constitution of the United States, to say nothing of the judicial law of the state of New York. So don't let anybody push you around. You want to go watch a court, you go watch a court anytime. In fact, it's sort of your civic duty to do so. You should keep your eye on these judges. Well, they try to get away with so much because they know that no one can watch them.
There's a copy of the summons. And as usual, the police do not write legibly, and this is no accident. It's deliberate. It's a form of cover-up, a form of lying. PHR job isn't getting done because of the law-breaking of Cablevision, Continental, and TCI. I did leave a message with Inspector Mercado of the Division of Housing and Community, DHCR, Division of Housing and Community, what? And that my cause of action is reduced rent for decreased services, and that the two decreased services are water in the cellar, plopping through puddles every time you go to do your laundry or when you go to your bin, your locker. And the other cause is paying $28 a month for a furnace which broke down and was replaced before we even got here, and for a furnace that has broken down 31 times since we got here. That I left the microphone in the drawer. I certainly apologize to the technical people at White Plains Public Access and at TCI Public Access. That's a dumb thing to do. And it happens altogether too much. This is Americans for a Better America. I'd like to read to you about their court reform. The legal system has evolved band-aid approach into a cumbersome and unwieldy complexity where ignorance of the laws is an excuse because everyone would have to be experts to understand it, and that's not right. Throughout time, nations with complex systems of law have come and gone. The Code of New York fills 18 shelves. One should be able to go to the courthouse and on a plain piece of paper state one's problem. Canon. And if anybody knows about lenses, it's Canon. Better than Perkin Elmer. Or Elmer Perkin, whatever they are. One should be able to go to the courthouse and on a plain piece of paper state one's problem. Any forms required should be supplied. Justice can be immediate. Wasting time only serves to justify incompetence. Justice must also be given little or no cost.
not out of the public's reach. The law shouldn't be out of the public's reach. The law is for the public. You shouldn't have to have a lawyer. And the costs should not be out of the public's reach, and they are, because we have the old ripoff of the court stenographers, $5 a page. And margins this big and this big, top and bottom. And words as far apart, and some words with the letters double-spaced. So, and then, of course, the solicitousness of the judges for these court reporters is absolutely wrong. A judge should be impartial. Welcome to everybody to chat with Glendora, the Nassau County edition, the Long Island edition. The doctor said to Arthur, you are coughing more easily this morning. And Arthur says, I should be. I was up all night rehearsing. Peter likes his doctor. He just doesn't like the fact that the doctor stores his hypodermic needles in a dartboard. And John complains that when the doctor operated on him, the doctor left a sponge inside of him. And his friend Richard said, why, that must be painful. John says, no, it really isn't painful. It just makes me thirsty. We are reporting to you on the law breaking of Cablevision, Charles Dolan, John Tata, William Quinn, Mark Westgarten, Francis Randolph, Joseph Asnara, Cablevision Systems Corporation. And we remind, here's a nice letter that came in. Request for the Happy Book by letter, because then you're sure of the address and the Happy Book is sent out and doesn't come back. But this is a nice one for Joe Fontanetta. And he says, Dear Glendora, you are doing a great job. Please send a copy of your Happy Book. To me, best wishes, Joe Fontanetta. Thank you, Joe. God bless you. Now, folks, if you know anybody out there in Nassau County who used to work for Cablevision, please let us know. We want some inside information, and that's a very good way to get it. If you know of anything that's going on out there, why Cablevision took Glendora's program off the TV, let us know. Of course, the answer is obvious. They took it off TV because one of the political people, and I think it's James Picken, asked him to. Because the political people in 1993 didn't want their bad record read on TV. It was a true record about the consumer affairs, allowing Scott Lord to operate a home improvement business with no license. Atlantis Lawn Sprinklers, this year it's forever green. Oh, it might have changed by now. About time. It changes about every January. about Thomas Galata and James Picken, knowing full well that Scott Lord was operating in violation of Local Law 6 in Nassau County, was operating a business without a consumer affairs license and not protecting you consumers in Nassau County, which is his job and is the money that you pay him to do. So we are going to go to One Media Crossway in Woodbury, and we're going to pick it. Glendora's going to tell about the law breaking and lying and covering up of all of the defendants of Cablevision, and we're going to pass out flyers. We're going to ask for inside information if you know of any, or if you know of anybody who knows any, then absolutely your name will never be mentioned. So we can get some inside information. It's too bad that Cablevision, we all know why they did it, we told you that, but it's too bad that they lie with all of their afterthoughts, that Glendora's sponsor wasn't in the franchise area, that Glendora was from Westchester, and this is all adjudicated, res judicata. Judge Bryant ruled that Glendora's residency had nothing to do with it, and that Cablevision acknowledged Glendora's right to be on public access after 6 weeks, and that Cablevision did censor Glendora's program, and that Cablevision is liable, and that Glendora has a private right of action to enforce that. And where are we going now? We have the deposition of Mr. Quinn that was done on January the 18th, Thursday. Deposition scheduled for January the 10th, and he reneged on that. Mr. Quinn had a deposition scheduled for January the 16th, and he reneged on that. Finally, Mr. Quinn did show up on January the 18th, and I deposed him from 10 a.m. to 12:20 p.m. It took 4 hours of preparation to prepare for the deposition, 1 day and 4 hours the next, and I had to cancel the court stenographer and make the call from way down in Manhattan. Diane Bennett said there wasn't any program for Friday, and she was right, and I wanted to send her a new one, but she wanted to go away. I told you that, so I bowed to her wishes. I asked for a tape of our appearance before Judge Fox, before the Quinn deposition and after the Quinn deposition, and the tape came back and it was chipmunks. It was recorded at the wrong speed. Callagy did not show for the Quinn deposition, and I'm wondering if it's because I told Callagy, when you come for the Quinn deposition, you show up with that $95 for that audio tape of Thomas Garger that you ordered, and that Judge Bryan has ordered you twice to pay, twice orally and once in writing. Callagy is a deadbeat. I asked Gerfind for a Strickland forwarding address. He covered up and wouldn't give it. I typed the Quinn report that took numerous hours. I made an oral demand on Callagy for the $95 he owes me on January 20th, 1996, on his voicemail. And I got the file paginating and log and mailing ready to print. And so that is up to date, and I'll give you the damages. Here is my receipt from Angela O'Donnell, who is one of my favorite court stenographers, and Howie Russian. Those two are my favorite. And that's for $50. It was actually $53, but she rounded it off to $50. And she sent me a receipt that it was paid. And those are for the minutes before Judge Bryant, when Judge Bryant sold me down the river. And gave Callagy the bright idea to get in an offer of judgment so that my costs don't accrue anymore. Isn't that pretty bad? This man I want to talk to him. I wish he would call me. Yavoli. I call the Oyster Bay Town Hall and there isn't any answer. I'd like to talk to Mr. Yavoli. And I think I can give you the damages for the week of January, 17 and a quarter hours, and $192.99. The law breaking of Charles Dolan, John Tata, William Quinn et al. Has cost us for the week of January the 8th, 1996. And here's the log that went out for the week of January the 15th, 1996. And let me show you those damages. $16 in 16 hours. I'm going to have to do this for the jury, and it's going to take considerable time. I've got to go back and add this up for 2 years, 2 months, the hours and the dollars. Here's the bill from the Manhattan 500 Pearl Street court stenographers, who are about the worst ripoff. They tried to get away with this for $206. So I pointed out a few laws to them, and they got it down to $106. You see, these are the minutes for Judge Bryant on October the 26th. That's why I keep saying October, because that was a big conference with Judge Bryant. This is a bill for $15 from the United States District Court, and that is for the audio tape, what happened in Judge Fox's courtroom before the Quinn deposition and after it. 5 hours to type the Quinn report on what happened at the deposition, and I will be reading that to you, that report. Felicia is better. She had a sore on her hand, and she's sort of limping. And I felt badly about that, but she seems to be getting better. Made a telephone call to Pat Weiss. I want to tell her about Cablevision. She has a lawsuit against Cablevision. She's a lawyer. And in Long Island. Sag Harbor. It's so nice to have the snow melting. The weekend majorly went to the TCI preparation of the ordered show cause, temporary restraining order. And let's see what's gone on this week. Monday was, I don't see any, and I don't see any Cablevision here. Western Video, is it? Something like that. That was rumored that Western Video was buying Cablevision. I hope somebody does and get rid of this management. And the fellow's name is McCormick. And I left a message on his telephone answering machine that I'd sued Charles Dolan 3 times. First time for $31 million, the second time for $181 million. And the fourth time for $298 million. And I got a call from McCormick's lawyer, and I filled him in on some more information, and he wouldn't say whether they are still interested in buying Cablevision or not. The light is going to be bad, folks, because the 600-watt bulb, which costs $33, got broken. You just touch one of those bulbs when they're hot, and it's gone. Just touch it. And so the light's going to be bad because the bulbs are on order, and it'll be a day or so before they get here. But that's all right. Just close your eyes. This is January the 18th, 1996, Thursday report. Glendora versus Cablevision, Dolan Tata Quinn. Glendora deposes William Quinn. He is not the president of corporate. That was Kofalt's job. The position has never been filled since Kofalt was fired in March 1994. William Quinn is president of the Cable TV Systems. He's the chief executive officer. Mr. Quinn scheduled a deposition to be taken January 10th at 1 p.m. Mr. Quinn canceled. Mr. Quinn scheduled a deposition for January 16th at 3 p.m. Callagy called at noon and canceled it. Glendora said then it will have to be before Judge Fox's control date of January 18th, before Judge Fox at noon on his lunch break. Callagy said, I thought it was January 22nd at 1 p.m. Glendora says, no, that is the conference after the Quinn deposition is over. Callagy should buy an audio tape and hear the judge's instructions. Wednesday, Glendora called Chambers and confirmed both dates. Chambers was not on top of it. A call back settled it this way. Tomorrow, Thursday at 10 a.m., come to Judge Fox's courtroom. Then have deposition and come back to Judge Fox's courtroom. And come to the conference January the 12th, 22nd at 1 p.m. Let's see if we can fix that light with the white control, the balance, white balance. Here is the white balance. See, that changed it a little bit. Glendora spent 9 hours preparing for the Quinn deposition. She had made more than 200 questions to ask him. Cablevision's canceling made havoc for Glendora, and the court stenographer, Tuesday, the court stenographer went to the courthouse at 3 p.m. and nobody was there for the deposition. The court reporting company charged an appearance fee for $25, so Cablevision, you can pay that. Now, pardon the typos, but the hope is that you are speed readers. Everybody else has a secretary. Glendora does not. It is not fair. Glendora went to classical high school and not Commerce High School. Glendora has to start videotaping her program at 6 a.m. Thursday. She and Franklin set it up, dressed up to videotape, and videotaped Wall and Cablevision and Gelman. 8:54 a.m., Glendora walked to the ramp to get the 1980 Lincoln, drove it home, loaded the Quinn deposition box into it, the TV camera, the audio recorders, and the other briefcases. She drove five blocks into the fog to the Quaropas courthouse. She parked outside, took the Quinn deposition box to the security guards, told them she would be back as soon as she parked at Lincoln in the White Plains City ramp. $33 million for a federal courthouse, folks, and they don't give you a place to park. Nice, huh? Nice. Now, here's page two. Glendora deposes Quinn, president of Cable Systems. Glendora went to see Clerk Paul to tell him we would need a deposition room. He said to use the jury room. Glendora went to Judge Fox's courtroom, and Judge Fox was the only one there. He was on the phone, he was at the bench, and it was a speaker phone for a conference call, and he was talking to two lawyers about discovery, and he was saying the same things to the two lawyers that he says to us. Jerome came in about 10 to 10. Two men came in. Judge Fox got up and left. One man said, "Are you Glendora?" He must not have cable TV, huh? The other man was big and tall, about 250 pounds. One was Glendora. Glendora asked for business cards. Daniel G. Gerfine from Satterlee, Stevens, Burke & Burke, the paid liars. And the other was the big one, William Quinn. And I will show you his business card. See, in this kind of light, the camera can't focus the way it can in the 600-watt light. And there's Gerfine's card. Glendora shook their hands. Quinn is good-looking. He's very tall. He's very Irish. He's blonde, and he has blue eyes. And Glendora likes Irish people. There were other lawyers around. How can they be around when they are square? Judge Fox told Jerome to call the case. Jerome never did. We just went up to the tables. Callagy did not show. Isn't that funny? It is like the appellate division when he did not show up to defend Cofault, Cablevision, Dolan, Todd, or Quinn there. Part two, Judge Fox asked if all parties were present. Yes, he seemed pleased by that. He said the deposition was limited to 2 hours. He said to report to him after it was over. Judge Fox works all the time, apparently. Glendora asked him if he signed her IFP. He said no. He said it was up to the district judge, and Glendora said the book said he could sign it, a magistrate judge. Judge Fox never answered. The four of us left for the deposition room. Glendora went to the clerks. Paul and Carl seemed over-exercised about a room. Paul has said the jury room, and then they seemed to have changed their minds, and one group was in the deposition room, and another group was waiting for a room. And Glendora asked Carl if he were going to carry her bags. And Mr. Quinn was very solicitous of Glendora's big box and carried it for her all the way to the first floor and to the jury room, and that was very nice. It was a room the same size but with a round table, seating four. Glendora said this was her dinner party and she wanted her guests seated as follows. This is a dinner party that costs about $500 because you have to pay the court stenographers. Vera, court stenographer, to Glendora's left. Mr. Quinn, court stenographer's left and opposite Glendora. And Mr. Gerfine, to Glendora's right. But the time we had the delay of the room, it was 12:13 p.m. when we started, and Glendora noted the time, and Glendora checked Rule 30 to make sure we got a record of all that it requires. Mr. Quinn was born in Brooklyn, went to a parochial school there, and listed the places he had worked. He worked a teleprompter in engineering. Glendora did not ask him if he were involved in the scandal there that sent Khan to jail, one of our first cable TV operators to go to jail. I wish that we had the force that we had in those years. That was way back in 1970. Why don't we send these cable operators to jail? The first big crooked cable TV operator the country knew, but she did ask him if he knew Bill Bresnan, who was president, and Quinn said yes, he knew of him. Mr. Quinn knew Mr. Kofall's home location in Lloyd Harbor. He said the last he talked to Mr. Kofall, he was looking around for a position. Doesn't sound to me like he quit. It sounds to me like he was fired. Was he fired? No. Was he second in command? Yes. Was he as high in cable vision as a non-Dolan could get? Why did he leave the company? To pursue other interests. Ha, 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 recorded an announcement. But he was president, and you are president. What is the difference between the two presidents? I'm president of cable operations, COO, chief operating officer. Khan was president of corporate. Glendora pointed out that the position of president of corporate has never been filled, and Quinn agreed. Glendora produced her Cablevision stock certificate. What name is that in the left-hand corner? James A. Kofall. What title? President. Folks, why would a man who was president leave such a big job and be looking around for another job right after Glendora filed three lawsuits against Cablevision? Kofall. Nobody is talking. Find me an ex-employee, folks. Glendora produced the 1993 annual report, the last decent annual report Cablevision managed to get together. The others since have been last-minute, homemade jobs. Do you know the people in this picture? Can you name them? Charles Dolan, James Kofall, William Bell, Mark Luskart, James Dolan, and John Todd. Did you and Mr. Kofall meet socially? Yes. Were you ever at his home? Yes. Where does Mr. Kofall work now? I don't know. Where does he live? Did you know his daughter? Does she live in Manhattan? Her name is Rita. I don't know. Do you know that Mr. Kofall is now in the 703 area code region? That's Virginia. No. When is the last time you talked to him? And you'll have to see the transcript. But I got the idea it wasn't very recent. Certainly wasn't. If you can believe it, it wasn't since Mr. Kofall was a teenager. Do you know James Pickens? Yes. We have met on various occasions about business. Did you go to Mr. Pickens' office, 100 Old Country Road, or whatever it is, in Lowell? We're on page 4. Now Glendora has... Yes. Yes, Mr. Quinn said, yes, I did. Now, Glendora has hypothesis number 3. Mr. Picken told his friend, Mr. Quinn, to get Glendora's show off the TV. Mr. Picken did not like having his bad record read on TV every Friday night. Glendora was saying that Mr. Picken knew full well that Scott Lord was operating as a home improvement contractor without a consumer affairs license. Mr. Picken is the commissioner of consumer affairs in Nassau County, so that is very revealing that Mr. Quinn and Mr. Picken met several times. Judge Fox wants to know who is the decision maker. Well, Mr. Quinn is the decision maker. Mr. Quinn made the decision and broke the laws. Well, by hypothesis 3. What was hypothesis number 2? Well, Picken, who is head of the Republican Party in Oyster Bay, asked John Tata, who lives in Oyster Bay, and Charles Dolan, who lives in Oyster Bay, to take the Glendora program off TV. So they did, to win the points and favors of the Republican Party, which dominates Nassau, the in party, municipal franchises and all that? Mm-hmm. What was hypothesis number 1? Some political asked Buddy James Kofall to take the program off TV to get rid of the bad but true reports of said political. Kofall said sure, he did it. Dolan and Tata were away at the time. This started the lawsuits for $31 million, $181 million, and $292 million. Dolan gets home from Florida or wherever he is, gone away, and he finds out and he fires Kofall. Part 3. It is amazing how these people sit across from the table from you and show total ignorance of public access law and yet testify they have been in public access all these years and they make all the public access decisions. Don't you think that's rather hard to believe? Well, it's hard to believe this ignorant of the law, number one. Number two, that they've been in public access all these years, or been in cable all these years. Number three, they make all the decisions and they don't know anything. And that their lawyer, Charles Forman, never knew the law. It is unbelievable how all of these people didn't do that. Osnara, Forman, Garger, and Quinn, when asked if they know Title 47, United States Code 531E, no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel. You ask them if they know that. Oh. It is uncivilized how they claim they have not read the judge's decisions. Here they are, a defendant in these decisions, and we're on page 5, and they haven't read the decisions. First of all, do you believe it? All right, supposing you believe it, yes, it's true. They haven't read the decision. What do you think of it then? Glendora had done no reading in preparation. Oh, excuse me, Quinn. Oh, Glendora had done what? Was it 9 hours? Quinn had done no reading in preparation for this deposition, he said. He had not read the Osnara deposition, and he had no idea what was going on. He refused to answer if he were a registered voter. He refused to answer if he were a reporter. He said he did not know what town Pickin lived in. The only thing that Quinn laid on the table was his roll aids. He had several of them starting around 11:30 a.m. and he went through half a package, I believe. He had no answer why Glendora was not given any notice, why Garger called 5 hours before the program was to go on to say it wasn't going on again. Glendora asked him why he did not consult Glendora. He came up with nothing believable. Why wasn't Glendora consulted? Because the decision was to get favors from the Republican Party, from Pickin and Gulotta, who did not want their bad but true record read on the TV every Friday night. When Glendora asked if it were not unusual for executives to get involved in taking a public access program off TV, he really had no answer. He didn't know when the decision was made. He thought it was 3 weeks before November 12, 1993, Friday, the day Garger met with Osnara in the afternoon and called Glendora at 4:50 p.m. That is, he said he didn't know. He said he reports to Charles Dolan directly. He mentioned Cablevision's telephone company. Glendora told him honestly and Franklin that the scoop, I'd like to get the scoop, that the scope of the discovery was to prove what we all know, that some political who did not want to, his bad record, true but bad, read on TV every week, asked Cablevision or coerced Cablevision to take it off. Glendora asked if he knew that and he said he did not. Gerfein wanted to mark the stock certificate as an exhibit. Glendora said you cannot put a mark on a stock certificate. She would not allow him to mark it. Glendora showed him the letter, 2 pages. The only document that Cablevision produced out of 24 demanded, Garger to Osnara. He had never seen the document. Gerfein wanted to mark it as an exhibit, and it was already marked as such, plaintiff's exhibit number 1. Glendora asked Mr. Quinn if he had a file on Glendora. He said, no, is this reasonable, I ask you folks? There was no file. As a matter of this size, and there is no file on it, does that show lies, cover up, destruction of evidence? Because he doesn't want us to know that some politico, his friend Pickin, asked him to take the program off TV and stop. Suzanne asked Mary Ellen, did your father die a natural death? And Mary Ellen said, no, he had a doctor. And Dominic went to the doctor and he says, doctor, doctor, there's a ringing in my ears. And the doctor said, don't answer it. And Anthony was told by the doctor to take a pill every day, walk a mile a day, and at the end of the month, call me. So at the end of the month, Anthony called the doctor, and he says, Doc, what do I do now? I'm out of pills. I'm 30 miles from home.
Folks, here's a Bible passage for you. Just remember this, if you're standing up for your rights, people will take your rights left and right. for their own selfish purposes. So then, this is from Romans chapter 14, verse 12. Every one of us shall give account of himself to God. That's everyone will give account of himself to God. So this is the Nassau County edition for the week from January the 19th to January the 25th, and this is part two. The light is bad because the 600-watt bulb, you just touch one of those bulbs, it costs $33 a piece. You just touch one of them while it's on, that's the end. And the other ones are on order, and we don't have them, so the light is bad. Just close your eyes. Even in good light, I look bad. In this light, I look like a worthless mother. Maybe I am. I wanted to tell you about Timothy. He said, I see spots before my eyes. And Anthony says, have you seen a doctor? And Timothy says, no, just spots. And Marilyn was sure that her son is going to grow up to be a doctor because he's already collecting old magazines. And the doctor told Jefferson, I can do nothing for your sickness. There's nothing more I can do for you. Your sickness is hereditary. And so Jefferson says, okay, send the bill to my father. I'm reading to you a report from the deposition of William A. Quinn, who is the president of Cablevision Cable Systems. He's not the president of corporate. James Cofault was the president of corporate, He signed my stock certificate, James Cofault. I believe he was fired because of the lawsuits and because he let people break the law. That is my hypothesis, too. But Mr. Quinn came to White Plains, and Glendora deposed Mr. Quinn for 2 hours from 10:13 a.m. to 12:13 p.m. with a conference with Judge Fox before and a conference with Judge Fox afterwards. Now, Callagy did not show up. Robert N. Callagy, their lawyer, did not show up. And he lost ground by not being there, folks. We are on page 6. Gerfine did not know the sensitive areas. Callagy would have covered up the revelation that Quinn and Pickin met several times in Pickin's office. Gerfine would not let Quinn answer when Glendora asked the obvious question, why didn't former inform him? Non-informer. Informer populist. Why didn't former inform him he was breaking laws by taking the program off TV? Former is the a lawyer for the company. The obvious answer is that former Cablevision in-house lawyer doesn't know the law. Any lawyer worth a salt sitting in on these discussions about Glendora, as both Osmeyer and Quinn testified, would know the law and prevent them breaking it. But then the people who work at Cablevision don't know anything anyhow. Quinn kept saying they took the program off because Glendora was not from NASA. Glendora kept asking what law said that. Quinn had no answer. Glendora asked Quinn if he were aware of Judge Bryan's ruling that Glendora's residency did not matter. Residency did not matter. That Cablevision, in having the program on TV 6 weeks, had acknowledged Glendora's right to be on public access in NASA. When Glendora asked if it were not unusual for an executive to be concerned about a public access program, Quinn said, most of us live on the system. We're concerned about our product. We want to keep an eye on it. Yet, one of the depositions Quinn showed, he had not seen more than 5 or 6 Glendora programs, and not all of each program. Glendora caught the liars. Nothing in their deposition will bear scrutiny. Part 4. Mr. Quinn kept giving reasons that were wrong why they decided to take the program off TV. The program was not about Nassau County. Glendora did not live in Nassau County, and her sponsor was not in the franchise area. Glendora kept saying, by what laws? There are no laws about these things. Quinn obviously knew none. Obviously, Quinn did not know the right laws. They couldn't do this by 531E and 829.3, which says no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of access channel. As Glendora told you all from the beginning, Cablevision did this in their arrogance and in their ignorance. Glendora has won in 4 courts on this, and they are just as ignorant and arrogant as they were in December, or November, we'll say, 1993.
seen the program recently. I thought he was there to keep an eye on the program. The Osnara deposition was on the program for several weeks, yet Quinn testified he had not read the Osnara deposition or seen it. Does that fit in with the statement that we keep watch as to what is on the system? It is our product? No. But it does fit in with Picking asking him to take the program off so Picking's bad record wouldn't be on TV every Friday night. Page 7, what political patronage did Mr. Quinn get for himself by satisfying Quinn to take the program off the TV? Sin has many tools, but a lie is the handle that fits them all. The handle that fits them all is that Pickett wanted the program off because he did not want his bad record exposed every Friday night on TV. It fits in with Pickett refusing to answer Glendora's direct question. Did you ask Cablevision to take Glendora's program off TV? Did you ask anybody to do it? Do you know of anybody who asked Cablevision to do it? Glendora's asked Pickett that, these questions, and he will not answer. Pickett has never answered, but then we think Pickett is the one. Remember, it was Pickett who ordered a VHS made of the show, the second or third show, and the second or third show was about Pickett. How does Glendora know? Well, someone who works for Pickett, NASA Consumer Affairs, said that, this person said that this person had seen the show at the office on the VHS, because that person is way out, way, way out and couldn't get the program. Judges Fox and Bryant, Glendora and Franklin believe there are plenty of people in Long Island who will spill the beans on Pickett, Quinn, Cablevision, Dolan, and Tyler. They want to go out there and investigate the way we investigated Scott Ward and won on that case. We need the time to get out there. The time is always being taken by some lie of callagy we have to refute. It must be obvious to you that these people are lying. You must have the expertise to tell that. Why do you let it go on? Why do you allow callagy to deadbeat paying Glendora $95 for the audio tape of Gardner that he ordered and Glendora produced? You do not do anything about this. Glendora keeps asking you and you do nothing. Why did you let them go from May and to this day without answering Glendora's demands for interrogatories, inspection, admissions, and documents? Why should the court be solicitous of these lawbreakers lying and covering up? Why do you work against justice and into the hands of these cheats? What is your motive? Quinn was getting more and more uncomfortable as Glendora was revealing the truth. Girlfriend kept pressing for the deposition to be over. He kept saying the questions had been answered before when they had not, when they had been dodged. Glendora told Quinn he would be subpoenaed before a jury and would have to answer the question. Glendora asked Quinn several times, looking into his pretty blue eyes, are you telling me the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? His eyes faltered. I would rather own my soul and my self-respect, Glendora says. Irvine, as early as 12 p.m., pushed to end the painful questioning, but Glendora told them all that Judge Fox limited the discovery to 2 hours, and it was going to last 2 hours until 12:13 p.m. At 12:13 p.m. in Punto, Glendora ended the questions. She had asked Quinn if he had had any questions he wanted to ask her, and Mr. Quinn said no. And that brings us up to page 8. Glendora could not find her glasses. They would not show up anywhere. Then when she moved, the glasses fell out of her vest. The glasses intended for the blouse pocket had missed and slid down the blouse and the furry vest to the waist. At 12:15 p.m., Glendora told the clerks we were done since they wanted the room so urgently before. Now they didn't care. Mr. Quinn carried Glendora's box at his own initiative, which was very nice, all the way up to Judge Fox's courtroom on the fourth floor by the talking elevator. We have elevators that talk to us in our $33 million courthouse, but we don't have any parking. It was pretty heavy, the box was. We returned to Judge Fox's courtroom. There were 3 people at defendant's table and 2 at plaintiff's. Defendant lawyer was responding to a heated statement by Judge Fox, saying Judge Fox had every right to do so. Judge Fox cut the whole thing off precipitously with adjourning until 2:30 p.m. Then he called us to the tables. As the lawyers exited, the one who had made the right to do so, a statement broke into a broad smile when he saw Glendora, and Glendora knows him from the White Plains City Court. She likes the way he argues before judges. This is part 5 at 8:24 a.m. I'm typing this on Saturday. It is too bad Franklin does not have time to type this and saved you the typos. The hope is that everybody is a speed reader like Judge Fox. When we came back, Judge Fox asked his discovery of Mr. Quinn was complete, but he looked at the wrong table. Glendora is the one who answers that. Franklin asked Gerfine, whom he did not know, and who, excuse me, Fox asked Gerfine, whom he did not know, and whose name he had heard announced, if he had any more depositions. No. He asked Glendora, other than those that have been ruled on already, do you have any more depositions? Glendora was thinking hard, with her hands on the table and her head down. She knew she had to have more depositions. She knew that Judge Fox was about to deny them. So she was thinking hard, and in the meantime, Judge Fox had a change of heart, and in the interest of judges, he says, let me do it this way. You submit a two-page letter motion saying whom you want deposed, and have it in by the 25th, which is today, and it isn't done yet. It's written, but it isn't typed. Then he figured out the dates. 5 calendar days to answer, and give the other side 5 calendar days to answer. Glendora said, thank you, and Glendora mentioned that we had a conference scheduled for January 22nd at 1 p.m., and Fox acted as if he knew nothing about it. When we came in, Fox said deposition had gone on for some 2 hours and 20 minutes, and Glendora explained that it took 20 minutes to get a room. No, he said, okay, that's all right. At 12:30, we were done in Judge Fox's court. Glendora said goodbye to Gerfine and to Quinn and said, God bless you. And Mr. Quinn said, thank you. Glendora got home at 1 p.m. and resumed videotaping the program for this week, which, of course, had to be done before editing time at TCI Thursday at 4 p.m. And the time on the Quinn deposition was from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m., and that is 5 hours. Now we are up to page 9, which is put together wrong here. This is page 10. So let us move on. This is a deposition of William J. Quinn, who is the president of Cablevision Systems, not a corporation. Why do the lawyers and the deponents cover up their political affiliations? This is some afterthoughts. What are they afraid of? Glendora asked Mr. Quinn if he opposed the decision to take Glendora off TV. He did not. Did he say anything in favor of keeping the program on TV? No. Well, he should have, such as breaking the state laws and the federal laws and the mandates of Congress. He should have known these laws after 5 years as a general manager of the Woodbury system. Glendora made it clear from the beginning that the Woodbury system met Nassau, Huntington, Islip, and Babylon. Gerfine asked them questions as to which systems. Glendora then made it clear again that it was the Woodbury system, so-called. Did you get these, the word that Glendora would sue? No. Did it concern you Glendora would sue? No answer. Is Cablevision worried about lawsuits always? No answer. Glendora did, Thomas Garger said that Cablevision was always worried about lawsuits. Glendora did not have an opportunity to ask if Lemley is corporate. Guess he is. He is secretary and his illegible signature is on Glendora's stock certificate. Did you meet Mr. Quinn with Mr. Gerfine before this deposition? Yes. How long? Just a few minutes in the building? Yes. Glendora forgot to ask Mr. Quinn if he were aware that Callagy failed to defend him and the others before the appellate division, second department, Glendora versus Cobalt Cablevision, Dolan Quinn, Potter et al. Callagy never showed. Callagy was a default on Cobalt and whose fault? Why wasn't Bill Quinn in the picture in the annual report of 1983, Glendora showed him? Why did they put Glendora's program on back on TV? The court told him to, Mr. Quinn said. That would show him how wrong his dopey decision was, November of 1983, for his friend Pickens. Also how dopey Former was not to know the law. Former acts like he doesn't know anything. He should be Former, F-O-R-M-E-R. Glendora should have asked how many lawsuits did she bring against Quinn at all. What were the decisions? Who were the judges? What was the caption? And he was in all of them. William Quinn was in all of them. Gerfine kept reciting lawyer-client relation, which is a hoax anyway, and a bias of judges. It should never be allowed. It is a cover-up for lying. Glendora did ask how many letters did Mr. Quinn receive from her at home. He said about 100. How many have you read? And he said about 50. Who is the legal department? Glendora should have asked. It is Charles Forma, F-O-R-M-A. Glendora should have asked if Mr. Quinn knew Mr. Collado. And here's page 10, after which we're going to have some jokes before we do the last four pages. It's our product, he says. We live on the system. We have to watch what is going on. Well, then, how come he has not seen a chat with Glendora in the last 2 weeks? He watched it when Pickin complained to him and asked him to take it off the TV to squelch the bad but true reports about Pickin and Galata. It was much better without callagy. It was more orderly, more productive, and faster. Gerfine really did not know what he was doing. How could he? He has not lived with the causes since December 1993, 2.25 years. This is twice that callagy has not shown up to defend Quinn. No Dolan, no Tata, no Kofal, Kabelgeeson, Gargant, Lustgarten, Randolph, Nara. Glendora should have asked Mr. Quinn what Randolph and Lustgarten can do all day long other than play golf, and they are never on the job. Gerstein really wasted the client's money. He must have done it as a favor. Gerstein did not tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Why wasn't Callagy there? He wouldn't say, I do know him. Nor was he telling the truth when Glendora asked him Strickland's forwarding address. One blast from Judge Bryant and Strickland was gone 2 weeks later. Goodbye, Strickland. It was obvious that Mr. Quinn was lying about the real reason for making the decision, Pickin. Quinn said he saw Pickin several times. I would not want a public record of lying. I would not want to sell my soul. I like standing before God and knowing that I did right. Glendora told Mr. Quinn that Judge Fox ejected Forman from his courtroom. Judge Fox said that Forman was making faces, and Judge Fox told him to leave. Forman was sitting in the gallery. Glendora's back to him. Glendora's back was to him. Why? Because she was deposing Gardner, who was sitting in the witness box. Going over the record, we can see that Kabelgeeson had not one lawful reason for taking Glendora off TV. All their reasons have been rejected by the courts. And Glendora does have a private right of action in 5541E, it should be, which is no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel. The decision was on content and content alone. Pickin pressured him to get the bad reports of Pickin off the TV. And we are on page 10.
Morris says that his dog is like one of the family. And Johnson asks, oh, really? Which one? And wait a second. Oh, yes. You heard about the meticulous doctor? Yeah. He used to give, when he gave a shot for the German measles, he would give two shots, one for East Germany and one for West Germany. And Douglas says that he has a dog who plays poker, but the dog isn't very good at it. Every time he gets a good hand, he wags his tail. We are reading you the report on Glendora deposes William J. Quinn, who is the president of cable operations for Cablevision, and we're up to page 11. Glendora asked Quinn if he was dictated to make the decision. He said no. Judge Fox wanted the decision maker. By hypothesis three, it is this fellow Quinn who is the decision maker. By hypothesis one, it is Dolan or Tata. And by hypothesis two, it is Kofal. Now Romans chapter 14 verse 12 says that, so then every one of us should give account of himself before God. Glendora would not like to have driven home all the way down the hutch across the Fog's Neck Bridge, east on Long Island to Woodbury with this on her mind. I lied. Glendora drove five blocks home and knew she did not lie about anything, and never has. Mr. Quinn took a position that shocked Glendora. He said, I consider that the COO, Chief Operating Officer, is higher than the president. No way. The chairman and the CEO is the top, the president is the second, the chief operating officer is usually third, chief financial officer. Glendora asked Mr. Quinn if the abbreviation for chief operating officer is COO, cool, and he said yes, and I said if you had two of them, would you be cuckoo? Again, folks, why wasn't there a file on Glendora? Mighty peculiar, don't you think? I went through the Cablevision deposition
three-ring notebook, the NBC notebook that I was given for commercial integration, and Mr. Quinn was so bad, either by poor memory, inattentiveness, negligence, or design about the dates. Glendora gave him a table. September 21st was the first show. October 1st was the second show. October 8th was the third show. October 15th was the fourth show. 22nd was the fifth. And 22nd was the fifth. No, that's wrong. The 29th would have to be the fifth. November 5th was the sixth. And then November 12th is when they broke the laws and got themselves into a pile of trouble. November 12th is when Garger told Glendora and said it was being taken off because of content. It was not the place for a party to discuss problems with another party. Why did Charles Jolin step down as CEO? And Quinn said he wanted to step back. Well, there was no answer to that question. Because Glendora said, why did he want to step back? Glendora should have asked, why did he choose James Dolan over all the other Dolans to be the CEO? That would have been a good question to ask. Oh, I did ask that, and he said, and there was no answer. Glendora should have asked, why did he choose James Dolan over all the other Dolans? And here are others. Glendora should have asked other questions. What are your hopes for advancement? Will you ever be on the board? Did the board of directors make the decision to take Glendora off TV? Are you a shareholder? How many shares? And this is on the proxy statement. And also, was your job endangered by this decision? Glendora did ask Mr. Quinn if he went to the annual meeting of June 14, 1994. We're on page 12. No. Who conducted the meeting? Charles Dolan. Did you go to the annual meeting of June 10, 1995? No. Who conducted it? I believe it was James Dolan. Why wasn't Mr. Charles Dolan there? I don't know. Do you go to board meetings? Some. Glendora should have asked, what are your hopes for advancement and will you be on the board someday? Are you corporate? Yes. Other questions Glendora should have asked. The questions were listed, but there was no time to ask them. Are there long periods of time Mr. Dolan is absent from the company? Mr. Tata? Who then runs the company during those long absences? How did Mr. Dolan and Mr. Tata meet? When did you first meet Mr. Dolan? At what price did Glendora buy their stock? What is the price today? Why doesn't the company give any dividends? Did you produce all the documents Glendora asked you to produce May 30th, 1995? Did you destroy any documents mentioning Glendora's name? Glendora, how did you first hear about Glendora? And Mr. Quinn's answer, I saw it on TV in my home while I was passing by. He meant passing by through the living room. Quinn said that channel time was so scarce. This is not so, folks. And the audio tapes show that this is not so. Glendora was given many choices. Bernie Gallo used to work for Tom Garger. Bernie is now in charge of public access for Westchester. Yesterday, Friday, when Glendora called Yorktown Cablevision to say the wind and the rain would prevent Franklin's coming until Monday, Bernie answered. Glendora should have asked, what is Mr. Kofall's background? Mr. Quinn said he has never dialed Mr. Kofall at area code 703, where Mr. Kofall is now. All Mr. Quinn has to do is to dial Mr. Kofall's old 516 number. It gives the forwarding Kofall number in Virginia and the daughter's number in Manhattan. Does Mr. Tata live in Oyster Bay? Mr. Tata has several wet residences, Mr. Quinn said. That's because he's a fugitive. It was good to have Mr. Callagy not there. Mr. Callagy gets abusive. He walked out twice on the Garger deposition. Glendora should have asked, was your job ever threatened by this matter? If the answer is no, then it shows Quinn did what Kofall, Tata, Dolan wanted him to do, appease the Republicans. Now we're up to page 13. Again, I apologize for the light, but the 600-watt video light went out, it was broken, and it cost $33, and they have to be ordered specially, and they won't be in for a couple of days. So here we are sitting in natural light. We're up to page 13. Did you ever have any complaints about the program, Mr. Quinn? No. I really don't believe that. I believe the complaints were from the Republicans whose bad record was being read on TV. Mr. Quinn had no adequate answer to Glendora's question, what was the reason for the urgency to get Glendora's program off TV, notifying her only 5 hours before the program was to go November 12th, Friday, 1993. You see, we've never had the answer to that question, but we have the answer now by hypothesis three. Mr. Picken wanted the program off. He didn't want any more reports on. So get them off, the sooner the better. Similarly, Mr. Quinn had no believable answer to Glendora's question, why wasn't she given a chance to rebut? Why did nobody talk to her about the decision before, during it, or after it? No answer. Glendora went over the things Garga said to her on November the 12th, 1993, Friday, 4:50 to 5:12 p.m. Quinn acted dumb, but then maybe it wasn't an act. This is the only paper Gerfein took out of his folder. Glendora came with a box full of documents. Quinn came with an empty pad and a book. Gerfein came with a slim folder. Vera came with a court stenographer machine. Glendora should have asked Mr. Quinn about Yavola and Mondello. Glendora asked Mr. Quinn if he had heard the audio tape of Garga taking the show off TV November 12, 1993. Mr. Quinn said he had read the transcript from time to time. Glendora should have asked Quinn if the company felt it was endangered by cablecasting a chat with Glendora. Was it dangerous to the company to cablecast it? Glendora should have asked, what do you think happened? Tell me honestly. The audio tapes make it 100% clear that the program was 100% accepted. Until Picken saw it and said take it off TV, and Quinn did it, and then they started making up all kinds of reasons. Glendora doesn't live in Nassau County. The program wasn't about Nassau County. The sponsor wasn't from the franchise area. And that is where Quinn falls all over himself, making up lies for other reasons they took the show off TV. It is lying. Glendora asked Mr. Quinn if he were under the influence of any drugs now, and he laughed, but then he delayed with no, figuring that he'd better answer. Are you of sound mind? Yes. And body? Yes. Quinn's answers as to what the program was about were very vague and did not show a good grasp at all, in spite of his excuse that it is our product and we keep a watch over it. Glendora asked Quinn if he ever wanted to take the program off again. He said no. Gerfein wanted the one and only, I'm sure Picken does, and Galata. Gerfein wanted the one and only document marked as Plaintiff's Exhibit 1, and it was already marked. Because you work too hard. Dolan was on the premises November 12, 1993, when the program was taken off TV. Quinn did not know. Glendora told him that she knew for a fact he was away on a very extended trip. And I think he was gone November, and I think he was gone December, and I don't think he got back until January. As Charles Dolan said over the phone on audio tape to Glendora, when Glendora says, you work too hard, you should have time off, Charles Dolan said to Glendora, I get my share. Was Todd a present? I don't know. Glendora said she knew he was away, too. He was in Florida. Do you have a dub of the program? This is page 14, the last program, the last page. No. Does anybody? I think so. On what format? VHS? I think so. Did you ever take anybody else's program off TV? And Mr. Quinn was quite vague. When Vera, court stenographer, asked Mr. Quinn for his address, Glendora gave him Quinn gave one media crossways, but Glendora volunteered his home address, Shady Lane in Muttontown. Glendora should have asked how much money have these lawsuits cost the shareholders. put all these should-have-asked questions into interrogatories. I want to find time to send out more interrogatories to Mr. Quinn and to Mr. Dolan and to Mr. Ty. And I want interrogatories to go to Mr. Picken. Send interrogatories to them. Did you damage Glendora's reputation? Glendora should have asked. Have you ever been deposed before? Glendora should have asked. Glendora asked, why did he cancel the deposition last week and Gerfine covered up and lied and wouldn't let him tell? Well, why did you cancel the deposition scheduled Tuesday? 2 days ago, Gerfine objected and said it was not relevant. Well, what a lie that is, folks. It is relevant. It caused Vera to come to the courthouse for nothing. Vera sloughed it off as okay. Quinn was better than Osnara. Osnara is offensive. Quinn was not. Quinn has a more trustworthy look about him, even though he was not telling the truth. Picken asked me to take it off, and I did. That's hypothesis three. Glendora asked the court to establish her questions that have not been answered as fact for purposes of litigation. He didn't answer the questions. They all haven't answered the question. So establish as fact for purposes of litigation Glendora's hypotheses. Depositions have to be ongoing until Glendora has the information needed and to which he has rogatory rights. Glendora asked Quinn if he were aware of the use that could be made of this deposition at trial, if he knew he was going to be subpoenaed to testify before a jury. He said no. Glendora should have asked Mr. Quinn, do you have any regrets? Would you do it over the same way? Glendora will ask for sanctions again, failure to comply with full answers, and all the other things in Federal Judicial Center, willful abuse of the discovery process and so forth, impeding, delaying, bad faith, to say nothing of just plain old lying. It is 8:40 a.m. This is page 13, Sunday, before church, and this must be it, the end of the report on the Quinn deposition of January the 18th, Thursday, from 10:13 a.m. to 12:13 p.m. I thank you, and I'm sorry about the typos, and here's today's joke. Fresh out of college, Peter has everything needed to be a success in the business world. What's that? Rich parents. Dated White Plains, New York, the 21st of January, 1996, Sunday. I declare under penalty of perjury, the above is true in all respects. Yours in truth, Glendora. Welcome everybody to a chat with Glendora, and this is what happened from January the 18th, Thursday, to today, Thursday, January the 25th. We don't have a light. The light got hit and knocked itself out. You take one of those $33 bulbs, and you so much as touch it, folks, and it's gonna just like that. And it takes 2 days to get a new one, and it's gonna be special work. So just close your eyes. I'm sorry about the lighting. Now for some jokes. Robert wants to be an inventor. Right now he's trying to cross an electric blanket with a toaster so that people will jump out of bed. And the boy wrote home to his father. The boy was in college. His name was Douglas. And he said, Dad, I've joined the drama club. And I've got a part already in a play. I'm going to play the part of a man who's been married 30 years. And Dad wrote back and says, good son. In the next play, I hope that you get a speaking part. Now, the economists say that things should pick up in the last quarter. And Patrick says, good, I'm down to my last quarter. I am reporting to you, this is the NASA edition, and I'm chapter 3 of the NASA edition this week, and I'm reporting to you on what happened in the Judge Fox courtroom on January 18, 1996. Thursday, unfortunately, the way this tape is, I found the last part, but I haven't found the first part. So while I've got the last part, I'm going to put it to you. We went to the courtroom. He saw that Mr. Quinn was there to be deposed, Glendora was there to depose him, and Mr. Gerfine was there representing, quote, unquote, cable vision from Satterley, Stevens, and Burke. So we went down, I deposed Mr. Quinn from 10:13 a.m. to 12:13 p.m., and we came back, and this is what happened after we came back.
before hours.
Put it there.
Okay, that's right.
Okay, folks, now I'll go to try to find the front part of this. I paid $15 for this. I think it's wonderful. Why don't they let us take our own audio tapes in? And then we have them immediately, and we don't have to pay for them. But I'm grateful that we can at least have something on audio tape. Judges, we've got to get over this, not letting people audio tape. Folks, I screened the first side, and it's not on there, so I'm playing the second side. Just let it play and see if it turns up. It just may not be there. It may be more bad work of the court. Here are the letters that you heard him talk about, Judge Fox talk about. January the 25th, 1996. Sorry, we don't have a light. Box 416, White Plains, New York, 914-949-949, Glendora versus Cablevision, 93-CIF. 8344 Charles O'Brien, and this is to Judge Fox, the letters that he requested. On January 18, 1996, Thursday, 10:13 a.m. to 12:13 p.m., Glendora deposed William J. Quinn, president of Cable Systems and chief operating officer of the systems, not of the corporation. The questioning and answering was productive. Mr. Quinn went through half a package of Tums. Mr. Callagy was not present, so the deposition was orderly, fast, and successful. Mr. Gerfine of Satterley was there and obviously knows nothing about the ramifications of this two-year, two-month record of lawbreaking by Cablevision defendants and of their elongating this litigation by their covering up and lying, something United States District Court, Southern District of New York, should never have allowed them to get away with. Glendora believes the reason Mr. Callagy did not show up is that she made a 10th oral demand for him to bring to the deposition of Mr. Quinn the $95 for the audio tape he offered of the Gardner conversation on November 12, 1993, Friday, 4:50 p.m. to 5:12 p.m. when the law breaking started. Mr. Callagy also is licking his wounds of his malpractice not defending Cablevision before the Appellate Division, Second Department, on January 5, 1996, Friday at 10 a.m. Glendora had the four judges all to herself. Mr. Quinn revealed that he knows James E. Pickin, Commissioner of Consumer Affairs, Nassau County, and head of the Republican Town Committee of Oyster Bay, homes of defendants Charles Dolan and John Tata. Mr. Quinn revealed that he met with Mr. Pickin on several occasions at Mr. Pickin's office, 100 Old Country Road, Mineola. Yes, Mr. Quinn answered. Glendora inserts here the reminder to you that a chat with Glendora on September 25th, October 5th, and October 12th, 1993 was reporting the record that Mr. Pickin was fully aware that Scott Lord, underground lawn sprinkler installer, was operating his home improvement business in Nassau County without a consumer affairs license in violation of Local Law 6. Glendora was reporting that James Pickin, I don't hear it, do you? Was not doing the job he was being paid to do by you Nassau County taxpayers to protect Nassau consumers from home improvement contractors who had a long list of rip-offs and judgments in the county clerk's office. Glendora also was reporting the true but bad record that County Executive Thomas Galata, Mr. Pickens' boss, was fully aware of Mr. Pickens' neglect and had written Glendora nearly a dozen letters about the same. Glendora's hypothesis three is that Mr. Pickin influenced, if not compelled, Mr. Quinn to take a chat with Glendora off TV, and Mr. Quinn complied. This is so evident in the deposition because Mr. Quinn has no knowledge of the laws, Title 47, United States Code 531, or New York Executive Law, Article 28, 829.3, that no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel. This is public use of channel. He has no knowledge that residency has nothing to do with Glendora's being on TV. It was so obvious that his two reasons, not a resident of Long Island and sponsor, not a resident of the franchise area, are excuses and afterthoughts after Mr. Quinn placated Mr. Pickin.
Ergo, Glendora must depose James E. Pickett. You have ruled incorrectly and not in the interest of justice in denying Glendora's rogatory right to depose Mr. Pickett. More and more, the finger points to Mr. Pickett. Cablevision defendants have never given any satisfactory answer to the charge. They were pressured by a political to get the true but bad reports about Nassau politicals off TV. It is obvious that this court has been strung along for 2 years and 2 months by Cablevision lies of residents, a sponsor, etc., and it is time for this court to get down to justice and get the job done. There is no alternative that makes sense. The record of this court is not much better than that of the Nassau politicals that was being read on TV in 1993. We'll see what the count is. We're up to count 156, and I do not hear the first part of the audio tape. When we went before Judge Fox, before we went down to depose Mr. Quinn. Dear Judge Mark D. Fox, Glendora further wishes to depose Bertram Patterson, an employee of Mr. Pickett in Consumer Affairs, who allowed, so far as his authority extended, Scott Lord to operate a home improvement business with no license from Consumer Affairs. Mr. Patterson was fired and should be a valuable source of evidence. Dear Judge Mark D. Fox, Glendora wishes also to depose Philip Sweet, investigator number 4 for the Nassau County Consumer Affairs, who is an employee of Mr. Pickett. Glendora has had more than 30 conversations with Mr. Sweet since 1986. Mr. Sweet was and is fully aware that Mr. Pickett has allowed Scott Lord to operate a home improvement business with no Consumer Affairs license. Why? Dear Judge Mark D. Fox, in the interest of justice and truth, Glendora wants to depose Charles Dolan. He lives in Oyster Bay. James Pickett is head of the Oyster Bay Republican Town Committee. Mr. Dolan is the CEO and the ultimate decision maker. He could have stopped this burden on the courts and on Glendora and Franklin long ago. Dear Judge Mark D. Fox, William J. Quinn knew James A. Kofalt well. Mr. Quinn went to Mr. Kofalt's home, 250 South Down Road, Lloyd Harbor. Glendora requests again that she depose Mr. Kofalt, whom she suspects was fired because of his role in breaking the law and taking Glendora's program off TV. Glendora's hypothesis number 2 is that a Nassau political pressured him to get the program off TV because of not wanting the truth and bad record to be read on TV every Friday night. Just as the January 18, 1996 Thursday deposition of Mr. Quinn proved productive by getting higher on the corporate ladder, Glendora has sound reason to believe a Kofalt deposition would be most productive. Glendora would like Judge Fox to examine Mr. Kofalt, now a resident of Virginia, by telephone in the Judge Fox courtroom. Glendora's hypothesis number 2 is that Mr. Kofalt was asked by an Nassau Republican to get the program off TV. With typical cable operator arrogance, Mr. Kofalt did this summarily in total ignorance of the law, another cable operator characteristic. The 3 lawsuits were filed in quick succession. Charles Dolan returns from one of his long trips, finds out from Glendora's mailings to him, Charles Dolan and Glendora were friends up until this time, that he has been sued for $31 million, $181 million, and in the 3rd lawsuit for $298 million. And fires Mr. Kofalt, his president and chief operating officer, signer of Glendora's stock certificates. The position of president has never been filled. Mr. Kofalt was the highest a non-Dolan has ever gone. Dear Judge Mark D. Fox, in the interest of justice and truth, Glendora wants to depose John Tata. He lives in Oyster Bay. James Pickett is head of the Oyster Bay Republican Town Committee. Mr. Tata is Mr. Dolan's partner. Now, these have to be in today by 5 o'clock, and right now it's noon, 11:59. The rest of this isn't typed. In the interest of justice and truth, Glendora wants to depose Charles Dolan. Okay, we did that one. I'm sorry. It should have been crossed off. Glendora left a message on Judge Robert John Hall's voicemail. Judge Hall is a bankruptcy judge in the Eastern District who did such a bad job on the 2 Scott Lord bankruptcies over 4 years, and Glendora sued him. The reports of all this were on TV also. And on January 19, 1996, Friday, Glendora left a message that she had talked to his boss, Judge Hall's boss, Judge Duberstein, at the 100th anniversary of the Appellate Division, 2nd Department, that Judge Duberstein said that Judge Hall was retiring. Glendora asked Judge Duberstein if he knew of anybody who influenced or coerced Cablevision to take Glendora's program off TV 2 years ago, and then Glendora asked Judge Hall the same thing. Judge Hall has refused to answer the last two questions Glendora left on his voicemail. This limiting request for deposition to a two-page double-spaced letter is an unreasonable restraint. It doesn't give a litigant latitude to expound her position and results in wrong decisions as to whom to depose, thereby ensuring justice. It's a callagy. I can't read this because of my own handwriting. Mr. Callagy is a deadbeat. He has not paid the $95 Judge Bryant ordered him to pay October 26, December 11, orally, and December 11th in writing. Mr. Callagy must be a form of populace. The United States District Court, Southern District of New York, is not doing his job. He is not enforcing Congress's laws. A third green cable operator is brazenly trying to eliminate public access. That's TCI and 21 pounds in Westchester. First there is Cablevision, then there is Continental Cablevision, now there is TCI. It is a national conspiracy. The courts are acting like wimps and are too soft on these lawbreakers. No punitive damages, 2 years and 2 months of letting them lie. These greedy, grubby cable operators are out to show you judges you have no authority over them and that they are bigger than you are. As a national conspiracy to overthrow Congress's intent, the United States District Court should show more muscle. Judge Fox, in the interest of justice and truth, please do not declare discovery over on 93 Civ 8344 Charles L. Bryant, that's Glendora versus Cablevision. The court has let Cablevision defendants and Mr. Callagy lie long enough, 2 years, 2 months. It is Glendora's turn now to get the truth. Discovery is not over until these defendants and their lawyer tell the truth. It was your good work that resulted in the telling testimony of Mr. Quinn, January the 18th. You have accomplished a lot. Glendora needs time to finish the oral deposition. She needs time to send interrogatories and get answers. This will be her third time on interrogatories. The first two have been ignored. She had planned to do this on January 22nd, 1996 week, but she was overwhelmed with a massive job of trying to get a temporary restraining order and a preliminary injunction against TCI from taking away our public access channel system-wide. The worst arrogance yet by a cable TV operator, lawbreaker. And that would be by February 1st. So you see, everything had to stop for that. Glendora needs time to go to Nassau and investigate personally leads that she has received. Further, she needs time to review 34 volumes of Cablevision files, 2 years and 2 months of their lying and cover-up, and she needs time to study Federal Rules of Civil Procedure and publications by the Federal Judicial Center. Franklin and Glendora work all day and sometimes all night refuting the lies of lawyers and defendants and setting the record straight. We sacrifice our personal lives, our other interests, and still we can't get the legal work up to date, although we have never missed a return date nor a court appearance. Believe me, the courts don't make it easy. Three of us are going to picket outside of Cablevision, One Media Crossways, Woodbury, hand out flyers asking for inside information about the Glendora matter, quote, your name will never be mentioned, unquote. Glendora has already jotted notes what to tell the jury. From your response, 1-18-96, Thursday at 12:20 p.m., Glendora got the impression you had not read our last mailing and had not noticed Glendora's application for informal papyrus. 12-27-95, you told Glendora she had not submitted a notarized statement of her poverty. Within a week, she did. She was expecting an answer before January 18, 1996.
Judge Connor just approved Glendora's informed process for TCI on 96-CIV-0140. And here it is approved by Judge Connor. It's too bad we don't have light. We really can see it. We have light. And here's the state finances here and here and there. And as you can see, is granting it. The rules say a magistrate can approve and inform a properties. Would you please attend the matter this time and decide? Robert Callagy never declares under penalty of perjury. He and Mr. Quinn caused Glendora and the court stenographers much inconvenience, canceling deposition dates January 10 and January 16. The court stenographer came to the courthouse for nothing. There is a $25 appearance fee for that. Thank you for what you've accomplished since you started to manage discovery October 26, 1995. And now we're going to send him a copy of Glendora's letter to the Second Department Appellate Division opposing Callagy's getting another chance for an oral argument. Judge Bryant, will you please make Robert M. Callagy, Esquire, pay the cost of the audio tape he ordered October 26th? Much gallon effort. Because of his traditions, the appellate division has endowed us with a strength that steadies us during the upheavals of human history and enables us to perform our work with the requisite focus and attention. Upon this milestone in its life, we recognize and honor our court's illustrious history and look to its future with confidence and hope. It's very well written. It's probably written by some intern. As to whether they do all of this, I have serious questions. I have had 13 cases before the appellate division, 13 appeals, because of the bad judges in the Westchester Supreme Court. I wish this were all true. Maybe someday it will be. Next week I'll read you a little more. So the college graduate came home and put his diploma on the kitchen table, and he said, here's the diploma from medical school, just the way you want. But as I've been telling you since I was 5 years old, now I'm going to go out and be a fireman. The college athletic department had three doors. One door said, if you're too wide to go through this door, report to the football coach. If you're too tall to go through this door, report to the basketball coach. And if you took a bite out of this door, report to the hockey coach. Now, Peter is always bragging that he's on the cutting edge of technology, and his mother-in-law says, yes, that's true. He mows the lawn at IBM. Buddy, we must bear this in mind. This comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat, that everyone may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad, we must remember. This completes the report on Cablevision, the Nassau County edition, for the week, well, for the days from Saturday, January 13th to today, Thursday, January the 18th. For you on a chat with Glendora, the company has a new contest. You send them $25,000 and they'll send you 25 words or less. And
Diane says, I wouldn't marry you if you were the last man on earth. And Joel says, no, honey, you'd get killed in the rush. And Daryl says, I took her to a restaurant and I asked her, how do you like your rice, boiled or fried? And she said, thrown. I'm reporting to you on the law breaking of Michael Gelman, who is the producer for Live with Regis, about his dishonesty in not returning my property. And this case has gone on since September of 1994. That rolls around to September 1995. That's 1 year, and September, that's a year and 4 months, a year and a quarter. And he spoiled another weekend. We were all day Saturday and all day Sunday writing Glendora's appellant's brief, reply brief, and Franklin and I typed it together, and then we typed the points, and then we went to Office Max and we had it printed, and Shireen bound it for us. She is so good. She does her work so well. And by the way, Shireen got 4 A's and a B on her freshman report card at Mercy College. So I'm very happy for her. So here it is, folks. This was submitted on Monday. Everybody was loafing. Good old Americans, how we love to loaf. And this was handed in, submitted to the appellate term, first department, on Monday, between 2 and 2:30 p.m. And Frank Lenore took it. And it's New York Supreme Court appellate term, first department, Glendora claimant appellant against Michael Gelman, defendant respondents. Appellant's reply brief. The index number in the civil court of the city of New York, small claims part, is SC for small claims 8347 of 94. Table of contents, table of authorities, the facts, counterstatement of questions presented, appellant's argument, Glendora's point alpha. Respondent's brief is untimely. It should have been in Glendora's hands January 4th, 1996. Glendora never received it until January 9th, 1996 at 11:30 a.m. Respondent's brief should have been returned by this court to the respondent immediately. That is the way the 9th and 10th Judicial District does it with defaulting defendants. Glendora's point beta. Because respondent defaulted on the brief, respondent is not entitled to oral argument. That is the way the appellate term 9th and 10th Judicial Districts does it. Glendora's point gamma. Glendora's reply to DiGiulio's point one. DiGiulio's point is substantial justice between the parties has been accomplished where a court finds that a valid and enforceable contract does not exist absent a promise and absent contractual intent.